Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air. But first, the normal, daily, early Buddhist contemplation. The Buddha's speech on friendliness. What should the clever one advantageously do to attain this state called peace is this. He should be intelligent, straight, honest, humble, gentle, and never proud, contented and easy to support, not busy, careful, and silenced, in abilities and senses, cautious and modest, neither flattering families nor be demanding, not doing even a minor trifle that other wise men might criticize. Then he should think, may all beings be joyous and safe. Let every creature's mind rejoice. Whatever breathing beings there are, no matter whether feeble or firm, with none excepted, whether long, tall, big, medium, short or small, whether seen or unseen, visible or not, whether living far away or near here, whether existing or just about to come into being, let every living being's mind be exultantly jubilant. Let no one ever kill or another being undo, nor ever harm anyone anywhere at all. Let no one wish even a minor bad for another, neither from provocation nor from revenge. Thus, as a mother with her own life might guard her only baby child, thus should he maintain a mentality of infinite friendliness for every living being, in gentle sympathy for this entire universe, unlimited, endless, and waste. As above, so below, and all around, unimpeded, without any hatred, purged of all enmity, whether standing, walking, seated, or lying down, while slumbering, he should always maintain such awareness of gentle and benevolent kindness. This very mentality is the divine dwelling here, they say. He that do not traffic with many speculative views, perfected in seeing what is right and wrong, purged of lusts for sense pleasures, he will surely not come back here to any womb. And the canonical source for this Buddha's speech on friendliness is the minor readings and the illustrator, the Kutaka Bhatta. Thank you. Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air, number 75, recorded September 2017 in a big rainstorm, which, by the way, the Buddha also predicted to be a result of collective moral degeneration. But we'll come to that later during the simile. There's one simile and three questions. But first, the normal intro. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Indeed. Remember to click subscribe down there and click the small bell down there so you get your ticket to Nibbana. And like if you like. There are, as I said, three questions and one simile, and we go aboard the simile right away. The simile is from the Nidana-Samyutta, the 12th book or the 12th chapter in the Samyutta Nikaya, which you see here, the connected discourses of the Buddha, which are connected in various subjects. This is the Nidana-Samyutta, the chapter on causation, on cause and effect. Mostly Samyutta or Paticca-samuppada, dependent coordination, the principle, core principle of Buddhist philosophy, but also various other subjects. And this is Sutta number 69, called the Surge. So it's a very short one. And Buddha, he called his monks to him and said, monks, it is like this. It's like when the ocean surge in, flood in, on the rivers, then the tide in the rivers increase, and the rivers, they then flood in, surge, overcome the streams on the water levels, the tide in the streams increase, then the streams in turn flood in, surge, overcome the lakes, and the water level in the lakes increase. And when the lakes, they overflow, flood in on the land, then the land get inundated, covered, and destroyed. Very relevant today, while we're having a lot of rainstorms and floods in Florida and various other places in the world. More and more frequent, actually. So the Buddha said, it's like this, it's like when ignorance flood in and surge, then this increased level of ignorance then cause mental constructions, sankhara, to flood in and surge. And when increased mental constructions, assumptions, projections, deceptions, conceits, imaginations, they flood in, then consciousness arise, cease, flood, and surge. Then when consciousness surge and flood in, then name and form, nama and rupa, materiality and mentality, it rise. So when this mentality and materiality, this process of naming and forming, of designating and manifesting, when this tide in that increase, then the six senses increase. So when the six senses increase, then contact is flooded in and start to surge. And contact, a lot of contacts with the external world, it's overflowing the mind, searching the mind. Then a lot of feeling arise. Vedana. When feeling surge and flood in, then this cause craving. Craving towards the object and a craving away from the objects, and craving for neglecting the object, being free from it. This search. When craving search, then this cause a search, a tied up in clinging. So clinging increase. When clinging increase, the process of becoming, of re-becoming of every moment, and of re-becoming in every life, this increase. This search. When there is a search in becoming, then there is also a search in birth of the next moment and of the next life. When there is a search in the next life, in birth, then there will also be a search, an increase, a flooding in of aging, sickness, and death. When there is a flooding in of aging, sickness, and death, then there is also a flooding in, a search, overcoming of suffering. And so this individual stream of mental and material processes, what a being really is, this is overflooded, overcome, surged by suffering, dukkha. While he said, when the ocean recedes, will draw back, then also the river recedes and draw back. When the river recedes, the streamlets draw back. Then the water level in the lakes fall down. And then the water will draw from.
New message is received from law.
The land. So the land can be dry again and flourish. And so he said, as also is the same, when ignorance will draw. Ignorance of what? Ignorance of the Four Noble Truths. Ignorance of suffering. Ignorance of craving as a cause of suffering. Ignorance of absence of craving entails end of suffering. And ignorance of the Noble Eightfold Way as a method to end suffering. Ignorance of that, when this recedes, because the being, the process of mentality and materiality becomes aware of the Four Noble Truths. Because of considering them, because of learning them, because of applying them in daily life. Well then, this mental construction, sankhara, also recedes, withdrawbacks, diminishes. When sankhara, mental construction recedes, then naming and forming diminish. When naming and forming, then the six senses, all the sense inputs that the mind is flooded with, in particular today in this so-called information society, where we are flooded with advertisement and all kind of stimuli, all the time. 200 or 2,000 television channels, and the same number of music channels and sport channels and so on. So this six senses flooding in of sense data, this recedes. So contact recedes. And then also feelings of various kinds. This chaotic, cacophonic storm of feeling. Emotional storm of feeling. That usually overcomes beings. This also recedes and is silenced. When no feeling or silenced feeling, receding feeling, then receding craving. No, not so violent urge for this and that all the time. Then becoming, the process of re-becoming, wanting to become this and that, wanting not to become this and that. This also recedes. Then rebirth in every moment and in every life also recedes. And then it means on the long run that aging, sickness and death recedes, which then makes suffering recede. So it starts with ignorance, this flooding in of ignorance, defined specifically as not knowing, not seeing, not being conscious about in every moment, about this four facts of one, all this is suffering. Craving for it creates suffering, absence of craving relinquishes suffering, and the Noble Eightfold Way is a method to end suffering by ending craving. So much for the surge of urge, which will be the fitting, I think, title for this Dhamma on Air number 75. The surge of ignorance which creation creates a surge of urge of craving, which then creates a flooding in of suffering, dukkha. To the questions. Question 233. Stream entry is impossible. It's impossible for a cula-sotapanna, a minor stream entrant, to die without becoming a sotapanna, a stream entrant in this life. What constitutes a cula-sotapanna, a minor stream entrant? And how to recognize when one has reached this cula-sotapanna? cula-sotapanna stage. I like to say first off the bat that cula-sotapanna is not a something that the Buddha told about. It is something, a development coming later in the commentaries. So it's strictly speaking not Buddha Vajana. It's not the words of the Buddha. But nevertheless, there are some good points to learn from it anyway. So it's not something Buddha have told about. There's a good video by Dr. Sayadaw U. Sunanda, a Burmese teacher who lived in Malaysia, and I give the link below about this cula-sotapanna. Basically, it is true that one who is destined for stream entry cannot die before having entered stream entry. And another place is also said that the universe, if the universe is going to crack up in a big crunch, then it cannot do so before those who are stream entrant, destined for stream entrant, a so-called cula-sotapanna, a minor stream entrant, or a junior stream entrant, they have attained stream entrance. So it's really something fundamental in the entire universe. So what is a cula-sotapanna and what defines? It's defined as one who knows cause and effect, one who knows causality, regarding at least three aspects. And the first one is one who knows dependent co-arising, paticca-samuppada, and can say backwards and forwards, just like I just said, from ignorance, avidya, come sankhara, mental constructions. From sankhara, mental constructions, arise vijnana, consciousness. From consciousness, arise name and form, nama-rupa. From name and form, arise the six senses. From the six senses, arises contact, passa. From contact, arises feeling, vedana. From feeling, arises craving, tanha. From craving, arises clinging, upadana. From clinging, arises becoming, bhava. From becoming, arises birth, jati. And from birth arises aging, sickness, decay, and death. And so is the arising of this whole mass of suffering. So this, the cula-sotapanna can, forwards and backwards, even if you wake up her or him at 12 o'clock at night at New Year's Eve, then they still can do that. They also have a very fairly acute knowledge of what cause the difference between human beings and among all beings. As the Buddha explained, the difference between human beings, that the human beings not look the same and are in different conditions, are basically their form of karma. So those who kill, they have short life. Those who do not kill, they have long life. Those who are cruel and harm, they will become sick and ugly. And those who are harmless and kind, they will become beautiful and very healthy. Those who are generous, they will become rich. Those who are miserly, they will become poor. Those who don't like to teach or don't like to learn anything, they will become stupid. Those who teach, like now, teach the Dhamma or teach whatever, mathematics, history, and those who like to learn also themselves, they will become intelligent. Those who are envious, they will become unpopular, they will have no friends, no associates. While those who are rejoicing in other success, by practicing mudita, neutral joy, they will become very popular, have a lot of friends and a lot of associates. So it's this distinction that the cula-sotapanna, the junior stream entrant, knows cause and effect, both on the transcendental level, paticca-samuppada, dependent co-arising, and on the mundane level, what causes the difference between beings. And every day also he or she trains, what's the cause and effect of this that phenomena? The cause of setting the foot forward in walking meditation. And this causes the foot to go forward. The foot to go forward is then, the intention to make the foot go forward is the cause, and the foot going forward is the effect. Then the foot going forward is the cause for arising of awareness of the foot going forward. Then the awareness of the foot going forward is the effect, while the foot going forward is the cause. Seeing, like you do now, there is a form and color, one, there's an eye or sensitivity for light and color, and there's visual consciousness. They are the cause for seeing. So then seeing. The seeing then become the cause for awareness of seeing. So this awareness, seeing, seeing, which you could repeat now, or hearing, hearing, which you could repeat now, this is the effect, while the process of seeing or the process of hearing was the cause. So this remembering cause and effect in all actions at all time points, this is characterizing a cula-sotapanna. And we again remember that the cula-sotapanna has given up all views. This is a cula-sotapanna is one who's working, who's on the path to stream entrant. But the stream entrant is characterized by having cut out three fetters. One, sakkaya ditti, belief in a self, belief in a me, belief in a lasting ego entity within this process of material and mental states. This does the stream entrant doesn't believe. He or she has no personality belief, because they have noticed this cause and effect, this coming and going of phenomena for a long time. And then they know that inside this process, the stream of mental and material phenomena of Nama Rupa, there is nothing that is identical. And thereby, there's no identity. There is only these mental and material states passing by, arising and ceasing, passing by. There's nothing in there that's the same. There's a me, there's an I, there's an ego, there's a soul, or can be mentioned as that, or categorized as that, at all. This is the first. So, no personality belief, no sakkaya ditti, no ego, no self. They don't believe that. The second thing is that they have no belief in ritual practices. They have no clinging to rule and ritual. So they don't believe any form of superstition. And also they will never take another teacher than the Buddha. Never, never, never. So they don't believe in any kind of amulets or fire oblation or offering or sacrifice or wearing funny clothes or hats or tattoos or anything like that. They know what mental purity is from direct own personal experience. And whether a priest take on this clothes or that clothes or go naked or have funny marks in the face or all kinds of religious or superstitious paraphernalia, then they see right away, this is crap. There's nothing to do with it. They don't say it like that, but nevertheless, they recognize it like that. So they don't believe in burning incense sticks, or worshipping statues or amulets or totems, and that's enough. So, so much for the cula-sotapanna. Basically, one who knows causality, who knows and reflects upon cause and effect all the time, and see cause and effect of every mental or material phenomena, whether external or internal, with the past, present, or future. Next question is question 224. Are the mental perfections, parami, permanent, or are they also transient as everything else? Yes and no. We just remember that the mental perfections is 10 qualities that one practices on the path. And they are generosity, dana, morality, sila, withdrawal, nikamma, understanding, panya, enthusiastic energy, virya, patient forbearance, kanti, honest truthfulness, satya, resolute determination, adhitana, kind friendliness, metta, and imperturbable equanimity, upekka. So it starts with an easy one, dana, a little more difficult, morality, sila, and then it ends with someone who's fairly subtle, namely universal friendliness, metta, and upekka, imperturbability, serenity, complete undisturbable balance. So this one perfect life after life after life after life, work on them. As soon as one comes to know them again, that this is the deed, either from hearing from a monk or from the Buddha himself or from somebody who knows a monk or the Buddha himself from books. So one will then, coming back to a life, then start on growing these mental perfections, these paramitas or parami, higher to a higher level. However, there is, due to circumstances and different cultures one is whirling about in samsara, then one will go up and down a little bit. So let's say you become born as an animal, then your ability to give will grow less, and your ability to be harmless will grow less. So because you maybe will have to fight as an animal. However, and in this sense, they are impermanent, so they are dependent upon circumstances. They can come under pressure. However, the understream of them, the subconscious memory of them, and how one has attained them, how high level one has attained them to, how much one can give away, or in the other end, how friendly one can be, how selfless one can be, and how peaceful one can be, equanimity. This will follow one from life to life. So there's a general pattern then where one enters one in the last life, then one will go have some fluctuations maybe, and then you will start from the same point, maybe degrade a little bit, then crawl up to the same point, and then start from there in the next life. So they fluctuate according to circumstances that the individual is meeting in their way through samsara. However, they always will be retained as latent tendencies that the individual will try to come back to as soon as the circumstances allow it, and then take them even higher. So they are, you can say, both transient, and there is also some remnant, some latent tendency that is remaining from life to life and from moment to moment. You can look at your own, for example, friendliness. This will go up and down. If you become angry or irritated, then it goes down. But then I have to come back to friendliness, and you come back to friendliness. Or same thing with generosity. Then you don't want to give because there's not so much money on the bank account and so on. So you cannot share so much. And then at other time points, you're very generous and unselfish, and have a lot of joy in giving and sharing. So there's fluctuation both on the short time scale and on the very last time scale, when one seems to come back to the same level and then tries to take it higher. So there's a progression over it, both in a single life and in particular in over many lives. When having them perfected, and one can perfect them to three levels, if we should take the Dana Parami, then the Dana Parami for one who is going to be enlightened as a disciple of a Buddha, Savakkabodhi, the enlightenment as a disciple, they will take it Dana Parami, the Parami of giving, like giving everything away, including all possessions and all family members. This is the disciple Parami level. Those who become a destined spirit to become a particular Buddha, a solitary Buddha, they give away a limb, an eye or a kidney or whatever, a hand. While those who are destined to become Samasambodhi, fully, perfectly self-enlightened Buddhas, they give away their life to somebody else. So there's different levels of perfections, three different levels of perfections of these mental perfections. I hope this answered the question. Then we come to the last questions, and this is question 225. What are the Nagas? And where are the Naga Loka in the 31 planes of existence located? The Nagas are a being, a special kind of being, which has the inherent form of a snake, very large snake. You can also call them dragons. They are living at the same plane as our plane in samsara. So they are living in our world. They are living in huge caves, and there are four mentions in the text, or in the ocean. And they get their babies up in the Himalayas, in the rivers up there, it is said. So they have a lot of power, spiritual power. So This word Naga is also used for somebody who has a lot of spiritual power, like the Buddhas or the Buddha's great disciples. They are called Mahanagas, so great Nagas. And this means that you have something power that is beyond human mundane power. So it's also meant as a kind of a compliment, actually. They can attain human form and do so at will. And the only time you can recognize a Naga from a human being, if they have taken human form, they can take up any form, actually. Just like the Devas also can modulate their form freely, so have a higher degree of freedom than we have. But nevertheless, if they take a human form, the Buddha said that the only time you can see them when that they are a Naga, this is when they are having sex or when they are asleep. Then they will take up, because they become unaware, then they will slip into their snake form, so to speak. And there's one funny story from, I think it's the Vinaya commentary, where there was a monk who was staying together with another monk. He thought he was a monk, but then it was a Naga who would like to become a monk. And then they were living out in a small hut out in the forest. And then the Naga fell asleep, and then the novice, he waked up, and then there were snakes all over the place. So he was described like that. There were a snake of this thickness, and it was curling up outside the window and inside the door. So he became metaphysically afraid, and then running, screaming down back to Jetavada Monastery, where he informed the Buddha about it. And then the Buddha said, make this being come here. And this the novice then did. And then the Naga came in, looked like a human. And then the Buddha asked you, are you a human being? He just asked him this question. And then the Naga, of course, because he knew he could not lie towards the Buddha, then he admitted that he was a Naga. And then the Buddha said, you cannot become a monk. You have to go back and then keep the poor days, the observance days, every fortnight. And then you become a human being. And then when you become a human being, then you can become a monk. And then it is told that the Naga left there crying, because he had a very deep and devout wish to become a monk, but he could not become a monk. And this is because I think the Buddha said so because they are known to be very fierce, very irritable, and can suddenly spring into homunculus anger. And their breath can be poisonous. They can kill many human beings in a very short time if they become angry. So they are not suitable to have as monks, because you can never assure that another being will not become angry for one or several moments during their monkhood. So some of them are devout Buddhist, and some of them are not. Therefore, I just say that this question, I also was asked. This is your ask as novice. This is a part of the ritual when you become novices, is you ask, are you a human being? Manusa, are you a human being? And then you have to answer yes. If you answer no, then you cannot become, you're not allowed to become a monk. So this is still within our disciplinary monastic rules because of this event of a snake, a dragon, a naga being trying to become a monk and was not allowed so. Therefore, royal families, royal Naga families, they're called Vihurupakka, Erapattas, Chapiyaputtas, and Kannapukkuttamakkas, and then there are two more. And these forest monk especially, we devote loving kindness, metta towards these four snake families. Because it is said, if we do that, and one of these snakes, they bite us, and we die from that, then they don't do that, because then they know they cannot become married. Then the other snakes will not allow them to go into a marriage, so they can have no wife or whatever is called in their labor. So they cannot marry, basically, because they have been reported in their society that they have killed a monk by biting him. So this we do regularly, and I also do many times, especially when I see snakes. Hear about, there's very poisonous snakes. There's a small one, a crate you see here, black and white stripes, 80% mortality and 50% mortality if you reach hospital, but it's impossible to come to hospital here from. This has been visiting this hermitage twice so far. At night, they're not very fierce or quickly, you can easily remove them on a stick, but nevertheless, if you step on them, then they will turn back and bite on you, of course. So whenever I see a snake here, I know it's a poisonous snake, then I will do metta towards the four royal snake families. And so far, I have no problems with snakes. Though there have been poisonous snakes here many times. And I can easily remove them. They never attack me. So they are easily angered and very passionate. They are in a constant war against some giant birds called the garulas. And there is two of these snake beings, these Nagas, that are very famous. One is called Mugalenda. In the third week after the Buddha, you see pictures of him here. Then there was a terrible rainstorm, and the Buddha, he was sitting under this Mugalenda tree. And then this Naga, which living close to this Mugalenda tree, also called Mugalenda, he came and curled around seven times around the Buddha and then protected him with his hood. While in this third week of after enlightenment, so for a whole week he protected the Buddha, so he was not rained upon. Another event just before enlightenment, when the Buddha, he has got his milk rice from the young lady you see here. Then he had eaten the milk rice. Then he went down, he got it on a golden dish. Then he went down and threw the dish and saw if it went upstream. If it went upstream, then he knew he would be enlightened that very day. And it went upstream. Then when it went upstream against the stream, then it fell down. Then it fell down, clink, clunk, clink, clunk, on the three other Buddha's plates. They were lying down. And then a snake being down there, actually a king of a snake, called Mahakala, a Naga king. He was dwelling right there. And he said, he lives 150 billion years, so very long lived, and sleep down there. One who's lived in the water. So he was lying down there. I said, two Buddhas has passed now, a third has come. And so they are very famous for that being, both Mahakala and in particular Mugalenda, which you can see depicted all over the Buddhist world in statues. One more thing about Buddha said Mahakala, he actually, when some relics was flooded in India from Ramagama shrine, then he took the relics and put it into a stupa that the Nagas had. And then when some relics were needed for the Mahastupa, then there was a novice called Sunutara that should fetch them. And he was very cool. He could do all kinds of stuff. So he knew that Mahakala, he had these relics. The Mahakala then gave him to his nephew to protect them, and the nephew swallowed them, also a Naga being, and then he made himself into a very thin membrane over a big swampy area, let's say 20 square miles. So he tried to hide from Sunutara by swallowing the relics and then making himself into a thin membrane. Very good camouflage, huh? Lying over a swamp area. But Sunutara, the novice, he knew that. And when they approached the shrine of the Mahastupa, just before that the relics should be deposited, then they came into tent of this novice and they say, they're coming now, you have to get the relics because soon the whole king will be here and blah, blah, blah. So he went to this Naga king, and then he said to the king, I need the relics. And then the king said, we don't have them. So he actually told something that was not true. And then the novice, he asked him again, I'll take them. Take what you want. We don't have them. Naga king then said, again, not speaking the truth, because he didn't want to lose the relics. And then with one arm, this very efficient and clever novice, he put the arm down in the stomach of the one who was snake that had converted himself into a membrane, got the relics and took them out. Thank you, he said, and then he left. And then the Naga nephew that lost the relics from his stomach, even though he was a membrane, he felt that suddenly his relics was taken up. And then after the Mahastupa has been finished, the the enshrinement has been finished. Then the Nagas requested the Sangha in Anuradha Buddha to give back some of the relics. And so they had a share. And so there was no war about it. So this is a story about these mythical beings, which some are Buddhist and some are not Buddhist. It is also worth mentioning that the Buddha reports in the Jatakas in his former life stories also himself to have been a Naga several times. So it's a form of being that have high spiritual powers and high powers because of have doing something very good. And then, but on the other hand, they have done a lot of humongous good. If they've not done also a lot of evil, they've done something evil also, then they have become a deva. But because they have done this evil also, in conjunction, in the context of have done humongous good, then they end up on this position as a very powerful, but also animal-like being, which you have seen pictures of here. Then I'd like to say again, I will make a very intensive 12-day meditation course here on Sri Lanka next year in 2018, from the 17th to the 30th June 2018, here in a Samadhi center nearby here. And there are already two that has booked their tickets. And those who book first, they get, of course, the seats. There's room for 20 people. So if you're interested, seriously interested in participating in this 18 or 12 day long meditation course, we'll start with going to travel a little bit around to see some history here, to the Temple of the Tooth, where the tooth relic are, and then we'll go and see Mahayana Stupa, where a collarbone of the Buddha is deposited here nearby, here in the central hill country of Sri Lanka. So, those who are interested in this 12-day course, please let me know. Those who let me know, they get the tickets. Thank you for your keen attention, clever consideration, and kind contribution. So, thanks to all the Daikas, supporters, and the donors. And also like to say, if you like to give food, classic dana, then it is possible via this online Kale supermarket, and I will give the link below. And food is needed here almost every month. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Indeed, may all beings, all sentient beings, may they become happy and rejoice in exactly that very fact. Thank you.
Snake skin. Once in a while, snakes, they have to sloth their outer skin to grow. So also goes for almost all reptiles and crabs. This is from a rat snake. Can be fairly large, around 4 or 5 meters. This one is a juvenile that been around here this night and put his sloth right here. Starts with the eyes and around the mouth, and then they crawl out their own skin from the mouth. It can be quite irritable because they cannot see well when the skin, also it goes in front of their cornea, in front of their eye. So they cannot see well. So one shouldn't touch them when they are sloughing their skin. An interesting structure.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Nagas Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. thank you. Namo tasso bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha.
As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamitaya will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.